Loveline is meant for an adult audience. Loveline may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion advised.
Now, here's Loveline.
1-800-LOVE-191.
With Dr. Drew and Adam Carolla.
What? Are you insane?
Hey, it's the Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew.
Are you hearing us?
Yeah.
No,
can you hear us?
There we are.
Dr. Drew is a board-certified physician and addiction medicine specialist. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Well, Chris Penn, brother of Michael Penn, brother of Sean Penn, guy who's been in, well, probably 40 movies, is including Reservoir Dogs and a few real good ones, is supposed to come in here tonight, but he's not here yet. So we wonder where he is. We had him on the TV show. Seemed a little drunk when he was on the TV show, to tell you the truth.
That'd be the word, I suspect.
But that didn't bother me. That's good TV. Show up with a few beers under your belt. So he may or may not be showing up tonight. And if he does, we'll talk to him. And if not, we'll do the show. You ready to go to the phone, Drew?
Let us go.
John.
Is this live?
Yeah.
All right. All right, here's what happens. Okay. I can climax without even touching my penis.
Wow.
Yeah. All right, here's how I do it. All right, I sit in the desk, like sit down in a chair, and then put my arms on the desk in front of me, and then extend my legs in front of me, and then gently, like, lift up my legs, not even really lift them up, like half a millimeter, just apply a pressure to them, like upwards.
Like you sort of lock your legs out?
Well, not like lock, just... All right, you're just sitting down.
You flex them, extend them. Rather.
Well, yeah. I mean, they're flexed, okay. But maybe not all the way. But
well, your legs are straight out in front of you, right?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Right. You lift up.
Locking them out, Drew?
Mm-hmm.
Right. Okay, but you don't lock your legs. You just straighten them out and then lock them into position.
Well, I mean, you don't have to lock them.
All right, John. Well, then what happens?
And then my arms are in front of me, too, and I'm like, I gently push down on the desk and, like, I have my fantasy, you know? And then, like, 15 minutes later, bam.
How many minutes?
Maybe 15, I don't know.
It's like he's holding an iron cross for 15 minutes? Is that what he's talking about?
You do this on the rings? What'd the Japanese judge give you?
Wow. That's a commitment.
Yeah. But you notice he said desk, which would say to me he ain't at home.
Oh, school?
What? You're at school when you do this, right?
No. Like, at home doing homework, yeah.
Can you do this with your pants on?
Well, yeah.
Yes?
Yeah.
Wow. Have you been with a woman yet?
Well, I mean, come on.
No.
Okay, because you ain't going to last a second with a woman. I mean, you understand? You are going to ejaculate when you open her car door at the beginning of the date. I mean, there's just no possible way. Can you imagine John when he's in the presence of a naked woman? This guy's having an orgasm by pressing his penis up against the side of a desk.
No, it's not even pressing.
Doesn't even make contact with anything.
It's like
we know, John.
A certain way. I mean,
all right, we got it, John.
And it takes like a while, but I mean.
Yeah, but you can do it with your hand too, right?
Well, yeah.
And how long does that take?
Probably the same amount, same amount of time, I guess.
15.
I mean, it all depends on how much you concentrate.
Well, it's unlimited potential, Drew. Do you realize you could hold two magazines?
Well, you could just lay out a whole thing for yourself there, huh?
You'd have a whole porn buffet, and you have two hands free to turn pages. Excellent. All right, John, this is a very rare talent, one which you'll never make a penny off of, but it still puts you way up there in my book.
Well, it's pretty cool, right?
Yeah, it's good, but I'm telling you, the future does not look bright sexually. Because the second a woman performs oral sex on you, you will have an orgasm.
Yeah, right, dude.
I mean, she's going to be kneeling over. He's going to hit her in the eye.
I think he can prepare himself for any encounter he might be having. He'll be sitting at a restaurant thinking something's coming.
Yes.
He can just, you know.
You'll never complain about someone standing you up in a restaurant.
No.
It won't happen unless I get four or five at a movie theater.
During the meal, if he really thinks that something's going to happen after dinner, he can just...
Squeeze one off.
And then he'll be in better shape.
Yeah. And it's great in a hostage-type situation. You know, that's my biggest nightmare, Drew, that I get abducted and the guy, like, duct tapes my hands behind my back.
Oh, Adam, what would you do?
I couldn't masturbate.
I understand.
And some of these abductions go on for hours. Do you know that, Drew?
Shocked.
I mean, it could go on for 3-4 hours. No masturbation that entire time. Chris Penn has just rolled in. Hi, Chris.
Hello, guys.
Have yourself a seat. Nice to see you again.
This is the guy that wrote the movie.
Sit on down. Oh, hi. Yes, you can sit down, too. The movie is Florentine, and that's what we'll get into now. So put the calls on hold for a second. First, Chris, how many movies have you been in?
Somewhere around 40.
All right. I just, what did I say, 30?
You said
40. Oh, I said 40?
Yeah.
Well, that was pretty good.
You're better than you thought.
I remember, let's see, All the Right Moves from, it seems like, 15 years ago. And, of course, Reservoir Dogs and the whole Best of the Best series. But what are some of the other ones? I don't have them on your bio in front of me.
well, okay. The Funeral. Shortcuts.
Oh, yeah, Shortcuts. Yeah, you're great in that.
Pale Rider.
Hey, you've done a lot of...
At Close Range, Rumblefish.
Oh, yeah. Drew,
you... Rumblefish was the first.
You should see At Close Range. This was a true story, right? Or based on a true story?
Based on one, yeah.
And Sean Penn and Chris Penn played brothers who were actually brothers in real life, and their dad, who was Chris...
Walken.
Christopher Walken, who's excellent. He's got to be completely insane, but he was excellent in this movie. Madonna, like, did the soundtrack and stuff. It was a great movie. It was about 10 years ago now.
Oh, man, I wish it was, brother. It was about...
It was.
About 1984.
Oh. Really?
85.
Oh, jeez. See what happens when
you know what? If it was 10 years ago, I'd be much happier than I am tonight, because then I'd be that much younger.
Well, yeah, what are you kidding? You're in your salad days. Please, Chris.
My salad days.
Florentine is the name of the movie. I was just looking at this. It's the first movie Chris has produced. Michael Madsen is in this, who, of course, you worked with in Reservoir Dogs. Virginia Madsen, are they brother and sister?
Yes, they are.
Of course,
they play it in the movie. It's probably kind of a coincidence there. Right?
Mary Stuart Masterson, Luke Perry, Jim Belushi, Tom Sizemore, Hal Holbrook. That's a pretty good cast.
It's a great cast. Well, you know what? We went to this cast. The people you mentioned, I mean, Jeremy Davies. There were so many great actors in this. Burt Young. Guys that, you know, maybe aren't leading men, including myself, but great actors.
Right.
Great people. But the thing that brought people to this project was the script. I mean, it was really a character-driven piece. It was a slice of the American life, and I think it pays off. So when people read something they can relate to, that they... I went to a club the other night with him. This is Tom, the writer.
Hi, Tom.
Hi, how are you?
And, you know, you couldn't, all the kids today, they like to go to clubs and you can't hear anything. You can't even hear people talk.
Right, right.
Same thing with the movies.
Right.
They want to just action, body language, dance.
Right.
You know, can I say screw?
Yeah, say screw. Yeah.
You know, whatever. It's all physical. There's no communication with anybody. And this movie really was about people talking.
What's it about?
It was a hard sell, let me tell you. No sex, no violence, you know.
Yeah,
it's not about anything. It's about life.
Well, it
I mean, anything in life. Well,
one guy owns. One guy inherits a bar. It's kind of the local hangout. Tell me if I screw this up.
Oh, you're right.
Somebody's getting married. They're planning the wedding. There's a little dealings going on with some gambling and stuff like that. Am I right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, right. You know, I rarely read. Drew knows I'm one of the most unprepared hosts in the world, but we got here early tonight, and the outline of the movie looked real good, and it had all these stars in it. And it is a testament to the script, because people like that wouldn't get involved with this unless it was a good project.
Especially because, unfortunately, we didn't have the money to pay everybody
right. What
they should get.
Right.
I want to... Tom, he asked a question. This is the writer, Tom Benson. You tell him, in your opinion, what the movie's about. Briefly.
Exactly what the man said it's about.
Oh, okay, well, see.
See that?
Great guest.
It's a circle of friends. It's about eight major storylines that they intersect all the way through the entire course of the story.
Right.
And so it's not a hero-driven piece. It's a multi-hero story, an ensemble cast. And it's their circle of friends, and they're kind of on the outskirts of the American dream. And it's really a story about... tradition versus an America in somewhat of a spiritual decline. I mean, loftier.
It premieres at the DGA? Where is it? Where is it premieres on Monday, right?
Monday evening. Right.
And then the deal is if that goes well, then it shows up in New York and L.A., and then starts trickling into the rest of the country?
Absolutely. That's really where it's the premiere of the picture here, and I'm sure we'll get picked up by a producer, by a distributor, and then all the way out in the...
Right, did you call Chris? I know you work with guys like Michael Madsen and stuff before. Are they friends? Did you call?
Yeah, Michael's
calling some favors. I mean, the rest of the cast. Let's say.
I called people read a script, but once they read the script, everybody loved the script.
Right.
You know, so I didn't call in favors to have people make the movie.
He was supporting his friends the way your friends support you, Adam.
You know what? You know what you get as a favor in Hollywood? I'll give you the best description. This is the truth. It's not a joke. Is you get a quick answer.
Right.
That's the best favor a friend can give you, because if he says no fast, you're going, hey, thank you for looking at it, reading it, and telling me no.
Right.
But the guys that drag you on, that's not a favor.
Right. To go round and round with their agent, their publicist for Absolutely. 3 months. Christine.
Hi. I'd like to have a question for Adam.
Yeah?
Yeah. Did you ever get reunited with your stripper girlfriend?
No. She moved to England.
Oh. Okay.
Why?
Because you always bring her up occasionally.
I always bring her up occasionally.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, but I never said I was trying to reunite with her, did I?
No, I mean, just saying, like, if you ever saw her, and since you're pretty successful now.
Yeah, you know all that, all those fantasies I had of, you know, turning a humble carpenter from the valley into some sort of MTV national radio star, and then going back and banging all the girls who wouldn't have sex with me when I was younger. I haven't talked to one of them. They're apparently not interested, and I think they just harbor a grudge, quite frankly. But thanks for twisting that knife in my side just a little bit, Christine.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Do appreciate that.
All right, bye, Dr. Drew.
All right, that was it.
Huh? Said bye to him, but not...
Yeah, well, I think I disappointed her by not stalking one of my old girlfriends. Oh, Drew, there's no line two there, jackass. Chris?
Oh, yeah. Boy.
Other Chris. Chris, you're 13.
Yeah.
What's going on?
Hey, I just wanted to say that you guys rock, and I listen to you guys all the time.
Thanks.
Yeah. Well, my question was that at school, we did a school project where we would pick a topic and we'd write a whole paper on it.
Mm-hmm.
And my topic was, should we legalize marijuana or not?
Right.
And I just wanted to get your guys' input and what you thought about it. And, like what the side effects and stuff of smoking marijuana is, and, like, the long-term effects.
Well, I am, interestingly, not opposed to the legalization of the drug. I am opposed to all the ignorance and lies that swirl around it, the lack of willingness to look at it realistically.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think people are going to legalize it unless they look at the Harrison Act and reconsider all our policies towards illicit drugs in general, because it's a pretty arbitrary act, and it doesn't really fit the reality that we have today.
Yeah.
Is it true that...
But, you know, here's the thing we have to clear up in this country. Legalizing something's not an endorsement of it. It doesn't mean we're all into it. It doesn't mean we'd like every youngster seeing a prostitute and smoking a bong load. It just means we're living in a free society, and you can make a choice. If you want to give someone $100 for a blowjob, and she wants to take $100, or he wants to take $100, in Drew's case, for a blowjob, then that's between you and them. Or if someone wants to sit home and get high, that's fine. But on the other hand, it doesn't mean that hanging out with hookers and eating pot brownies is a great lifestyle.
Okay, well, I just wanted to know if smoking causes more deaths a year than smoking marijuana does.
Of course, smoking cigarettes. Nothing compares with nicotine's impact on healthcare dollars. And alcohol comes in a second after that.
Okay.
Okay.
All right, but Chris, 13-year-old Chris, don't get baked every day at 13. It warps your mind a little bit.
Well, I haven't smoked marijuana, and I'm not going.
All right, good man.
Okay, but are you going to argue for it, for legalization?
I'm not sure yet, but I'm probably going to go against it now.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Right, because Drew said he was for it.
Mm. Oh, yeah, sure he did.
He did. He's for legalization.
I didn't say that. I'm for reconsidering the laws that we have.
Oh,
making
okay.
Making them more
All right, well,
rational.
Let's ask Chris Penn. What do you think?
Okay, what I think is that marijuana does some negative things to a lot of people. But we should stop concentrating on it simply because we have so many bigger problems to concentrate on, and it's less of a problem than alcohol, which is legal. So we should concentrate on, you know, cocaine,
Right.
We should concentrate on AIDS. We should concentrate on things that are bigger problems. Marijuana, not too many people, I won't say no, but even not too many people crash a car or shoot somebody in the head over marijuana. Not too many.
Right. I'm
so
with you.
If you go with statistics, I would say we should tax it, put it with the cigarettes, which are also bad, and use the money for good.
Yeah, I think we ought to just work big to small in this country. Whatever the biggest killers are, whatever the biggest problems are, we'll start with those and we'll work our way down. And wherever marijuana falls on that list, we'll work on it. But right now, it seems to be getting a disproportionate amount of time and effort by everybody. Mm-hmm. And part of the reason is you make it illegal. And now you got Woody Harrelson strapping himself to a bridge and everyone's talking about. Now, it's become the wonder drug of the 90s because someone said it was bad.
Yeah.
As it turns out, you get stoned, it doesn't do anything for you, but who cares? All right. Where the hell were we? Rose.
Hi.
You're 26.
Yes, I am.
What's going on?
I recently met a guy about 6 weeks ago. We got involved, and we started having sex. And for the first time, I had an orgasm with a guy, which was pretty amazing. And our sex is great, but for some unknown reason, I just feel so guilty about having such good sex, and I really don't know why I feel that way.
Did you have an orgasm with a female in the past?
No, I've never been with a woman. It's not something that interests me. I've just never had an orgasm with a guy.
By yourself, you mean?
Yeah.
Stop saying it with a guy, because it makes me think it was with another animal or another.
I mean, sex. It's just, I've never had an orgasm
with a person,
with someone.
But
yeah.
You've had it alone.
Yeah, of course.
Okay.
Well, of course.
Because you would have killed yourself otherwise. All right, and now you feel guilty.
I do, and I don't know why.
Are you religious?
No. I don't know why I just...
What's different about this relationship?
It's intense. It's amazing.
Yeah?
And I don't know whether I've... with regards to sexuality, I mean, for a long time I kind of shunned it away and... You know, it was just something I've just become so comfortable with sex.
So in general, that makes you feel bad about yourself, that somewhere you learn that it's bad to be comfortable with this part of yourself.
I don't know. I mean, that's
evidently.
I'm having such an amazing time, but then, you know, a couple of days later, I just start to feel this guilt just build up inside of me.
All right, did your parents lay any trips on you? Well, say it, Chris.
No, I mean...
Let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
Maybe you're in love and you don't feel you deserve to be happy.
I don't know.
There is something
that
like
that. Pretty good.
Something like that is going on, Rose. It has to be.
Listen, you're not religious. Your parents didn't lay any guilt trips on you about sex?
No, they never... They were really open about sex. I mean, from a very young age... I was taught everything that I needed to know, not birds and bees, but the actual facts.
Drew doesn't like that.
How old did that start?
Sorry?
How old were you when that started?
I remember being as young as 10.
Well, since you're a 10, it's like, all right, today's lesson, felching and cornholing. Now, just listen up. We'll watch...
Well, 10 is fine.
We'll watch the electric company later. First, I want to talk about pulling out.
Are you sure they didn't start when you were like 5?
No, not that young.
All right, so Rose, you have no excuse.
I guess I don't.
You're in love. The guy's giving you orgasms. Enjoy.
You think?
Yeah, we're going to give you the green light for that.
Okay.
All right?
All right.
All right.
Thank you.
Yeah, what was her problem?
She just needed some sort of validation, some sort of go-ahead.
Yeah,
she sort of acknowledges. She really, surely believes there's something wrong with her for being that way. She doesn't deserve it.
When women are having orgasms with a guy, especially if they haven't had an orgasm with a guy, it's a major deal.
Yeah.
I mean, it is a bonding
experience.
Yeah, right. Guys don't have that because they're bonding with their hamper when they're in the 10th grade, and it's the luster's off the bond by the time.
That's all like Bondo,
I bonded with a tube sock. I bonded with a chia pet. I bonded with the beanbag chair. I bonded with everything, and I wasn't even out of high school. Melissa?
Yeah.
You're 16.
Yeah.
What's going on?
Actually, I just wanted to say to Drew and Adam, you guys are, like, really awesome. I was in you guys every night while doing homework.
Thanks.
And I wanted to talk to Chris Penn. I wanted to ask you about the movie you did a while ago, The Boys Club.
Yeah, I'm here.
That? With Devin Sawa?
Right.
Yeah, I, like, love Devin Sawa. I've been loving him since, like, 13.
Well, what are you, about 15 now?
I'm 16. I'm almost 17.
Uh-huh.
I'm an 11.
He's a very nice guy, and he's a good actor. I didn't get to know him really well because, you know, we're different ages, and we didn't hang out off the set, but I like him. He's a very nice guy.
Yeah, he seems pretty cool. I mean, I have...
He's a pretty good actor, too.
Yeah, he is. I think he's, like, going to be, like, the next Leo. I have, like, all his movies already.
Wait a minute. Drew's the next Leo. He's going to have to be the next Brad Pitt or something like that.
Okay. I'll have to keep that in mind.
All right. Melissa?
Yeah.
All right, we're going to hang up now, right?
Okay.
All right. All right. We'll tease a call, though. Jennifer's 23. Let me just say hi to her before we go to break. Can excessive masturbation cause your period to stop? Is that your question? Jennifer?
First of all, I'd like to thank this program for introducing me to the wonderful world of masturbation.
Thank you. All right. Turn the teleprompter off for just a second. You masturbate a lot, right?
Well, every day.
Okay. And your period has stopped?
Yeah.
Okay. Hang on a second
okay.
there.
Okay.
All right. I think Jennifer's a little nutty. You getting that fine?
Yeah. I'm feeling bad, too, all of a sudden.
Why?
Look what we've unleashed on.
That's all right.
That's a blame thing.
We're going to have a good time.
Don't even get into it.
Chris Penn is our guest. Tom, whose last name escapes me.
Tom Benson, thank you.
Tom Benson, who wrote Florentine, is here. Chris produced the movie, and it's a cavalcade of stars, this movie. We'll get into that. We'll get into Jennifer and what she's getting into, which is mainly herself, after this.
You have 5 seconds.
Loveline with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
2.
Back in a minute.
1.
Can we talk here for a second?
Loveline. They're treading water in a sea of retarded sexuality.
Loveline. Exclusively on Tucson's New Rock. 92.1 KFMA.
It's the Loveline. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Dr. Drew's over there. I'm over here. Chris Penn is our guest tonight. He's in here with Tom Benson. Tom wrote Florentine, which is the Florentine, actually, which is the name of Chris's latest movie. He produced this one. It's got all kinds of celebrities in it, and it's actually going to premiere on Monday at the Los Angeles Independent Film Festival. Wait a minute. Oh, okay. Right. That would be, it'll be there for the whole week, though, right?
No, it's actually just Monday night, 7 o'clock.
Well, what's the 15th through the 20th?
That's the festival itself.
Ah.
It's a terrific festival. I believe it's in its 5th year.
All right. Where do people call for tickets?
All right, Drew, relax over there. 1-888-386-8497, and you can inquire about this movie.
What was that number again?
1-888-386-8497.
You are a radio pro.
I really do know how to sell something. Chris is on the phone arguing with a chef.
But I like the way Adam throws out phone numbers. Big build up, and then you can call 567-4833.
I do not do that, jackass. You do that.
Right,
what are you talking about? I'm insulted. Jennifer?
Yes.
What's going on?
Well, I was just wondering if masturbation has excessive. Well, I don't think it's excessive, but compared to what I hear on your show, every day, if that'll stop your period.
I don't see how.
Unless someone gets wedged up in there, right, Drew?
That still isn't stopping your period. That's just...
You're doing it just once a day?
Once a day, twice a day, but...
Is there any chance you're pregnant?
I'm sorry?
Is there any chance you're pregnant?
No, not at all.
Are you on any medications?
No, I was on the birth control pill.
Yeah?
And then they stopped me because I started losing my period. And then they gave me another set of pills because I guess that one was too strong.
Mm-hmm.
So they gave me another set of pills, and they told me to wait until I got my period, and I'm, like, still waiting. This has been since October. But I noticed that lately I've felt, like, pressure because I feel that pressure constantly.
Let me get this clear. You stopped your pills in October, right?
Before that, actually.
When?
October, maybe about 2 months before that.
So say September? Early September?
Yeah.
September, October, November, December, January, February, March.
Right.
We're about 8 months out.
But I've had, ever since I started my period, I've always had a history of not being on time.
Irregular periods. Okay.
Right.
You need to go to the doctor and have them talk to them about this and in potentially induce the period. You probably, you could handle this over the phone, I suspect. They probably will have you just start the pills now.
How do you induce it?
Progesterone.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Couldn't just be me coming around feeling amorous. Usually women start their periods when I get horny.
The vast majority of women will have started their period within 6 months, will have completely normalized, in fact, within 6 months of stopping the pill. So this is probably a throwback to whatever was going on before that was causing such irregularity of your periods, okay? Did they check you out for thyroid and that kind of thing? You have no other problems endocrinologically?
Not that I know of. I know.
You need to have a complete evaluation. Make sure there's no polycystic ovarian disease. Make sure there's no thyroid or prolactin problems. It's other stuff.
Go to the doctor.
But don't worry.
Don't worry about the masturbation.
Yeah, it's not. It is not that.
Stop the periods of masturbating, please. Mine's going fine. Chris was telling us, Chris Penn, our guest tonight, was telling us during the break that he's opened himself up a restaurant in Las Vegas. And it's an interesting idea for a restaurant because it's an all-organic Italian place. And people, for the most part, love the Italian food, but sometimes a little greasy. I mean, you see all those big guineas in the commercials and in the movies. They're all fat, right? You won't get that way at Chris's place. It's called Baccio Organico, which means...
Were you raised speaking Italian?
Baccio Organico. Yeah. And I love the Italian food. I'm half Italian myself, and it's in Vegas, and if you're out that way, you should check it out. But so what's different about it, Chris?
It is totally organic. I mean, all the vegetables are organic. There's no pesticides, and the meat is all no steroids, no antibiotics, and it's completely natural. Everything. It's the first, actually, totally 100% the organic Italian restaurant in the country that we know of. And I don't want to get sued, but I've never heard of another one.
And all the dishes are the same, just made with those ingredients.
Well, no, I mean, not all the dishes are the same.
You have 40 different kinds of lasagna, but what I mean is it's the traditional Italian fare.
Yeah.
But it's just done with those ingredients.
Exactly.
I'm going to be in Vegas in like 3 weeks for a couple of days filming something. And I'm going to go by there.
Oh, cool.
Is that all right?
Go by there.
Yeah, I love that. There's something about Vegas, Italian places, and knowing a guy who owns it, which it really feels right, you know?
Let me just tell you this. It's on Desert Inn. It's 1020 Desert Inn. Go see Mario or D.D.
That's what I want. That's what I like. I don't like going to an Italian place and see a guy named, like, Heuschel or something like that. I want Mario. Yeah. Sarah.
Hi.
You're 18.
Yeah.
What's going on?
I pick up my friend from her work quite often, and I've met this guy, and he's real nice, real pleasant, just real, you know, good guy. And he's always been real nice, and I talk to him, and... we decided to finally eventually go out, and I'd known him for probably about 2 months just by picking her up. And when we went out, he was constantly adjusting himself, and I was just kind of like, okay.
How old is he?
I think he's about 20 or so.
Did you bring it up with him?
Black guy?
No.
Did you bring it up with him?
Did I bring it up?
Yeah.
Oh, no, you know what? I didn't, but I brought it up to my friend. She said she had never noticed it.
Every time Sarah says friend, I think she says son.
That's what I thought she said, too, the first time.
No, friend.
Yeah. So you picked up your friend from this work. And so this guy's 20-year-old guy.
Yeah, around there, I think.
And he adjusts himself a lot.
Yeah.
He goes for his junk out on the date.
It's kind of, like, discreet. It's not like a real macho kind of, you know, oh, yeah. You know?
How discreet could it be? You're staring at him adjust his junk all day, right?
Yeah.
I mean, if you know he's going for his junk, then how discreet can it be?
Well, obviously not that discreet, but no, he just kind of like almost pitches it, and it bugged me. It just bugged me.
He's not like doing it in his pocket. He's doing it from the outside?
Yeah, in the pocket, outside. It kind of just, you know, I noticed it quite a few times, but this guy is real nice.
Did he seem embarrassed about it as he did it?
I don't think he noticed that I noticed.
Yeah, let me tell you, it's like going for your junk is like cussing. And we have this problem on our radio show, which is if you go for your junk a lot, then you'll go for your junk wherever you are. You'll be in front of the Pope. You have one hand down your pants. Chris has written me a note. Chris, would you start talking to the mic? I'll not
be
your mouthpiece.
I think you should send her to Baccio Organico. It's probably an ethnic thing.
Is he Italian?
No.
He's not black and he's not Italian. Those are the two, as far as ethnicities, the two highest probabilities of junk adjustment there is.
What culturally induced.
Yeah, what is he?
He's white, as far as, you know, Caucasian, just
blonde hair, blue eyes. Who knew? He may have something going on medically.
He's probably got cramps or something.
Can I say something?
Sure.
Because I admitted some other embarrassing thing on your TV show. And so I'll admit one more.
Go ahead.
I have a thing where I touch down there too.
Right.
It's like a little, like a short thing. It's kind of a, I wouldn't say it like a twitch, but I mean, I guess it is. It's like a twitch.
Yeah, well, that's kind of how it was. It wasn't like a full-blown, like, oh, I'm itching it.
You know what? I used to get very nervous when I was about to fight, and I reached down to make sure my cup was right, and I think it come from that in a way.
Right.
But the bottom line is I'd go down there and make sure everything was in place, and then I felt good. It's a weird little mental twitch.
Maybe tell him and he'll work on it.
It means he's feeling insecure and vulnerable, so he's got to make sure everything's still
there.
Well,
no, it's like this. I have this habit of patting my wallet. I get out of the car, I pat myself on the ass cheek where my wallet is, I get out of something, I climb into this, I change my pants, I always pat my wallet, I want to make sure my wallet's there. Guys do that with their junk. They want to make sure the junk
belt,
is there.
The belt and the zipper, too.
Yeah, make sure the zipper, guys got a lot of stuff to worry about down there. Got to make sure the wallet's in, the zipper's up, the junk's in place, everything's talked. It's a lot of work being a guy. So don't crucify the guy, just bring it up to him, see what he says. And just do it in a joking way. What the hell? What
Cheyenne.
Is that, Cheyenne?
Hi.
Hey, you're 16. You're on with Chris Penn.
I want to tell you guys that you were great. You were like my heroes, and me and my friends are starting a petition to get the morning after pill going, like, in my town.
Oh, fantastic.
Good.
Where are you?
Springfield.
Illinois?
Missouri.
Yeah. You know what you need to do? Hey, do me a huge favor.
Okay.
Call your local congressman and see if you can get the state to legalize it, put it over the counter like the state of Washington has done.
Okay.
It's about time some other states got their act together and follow suit with what the state of Washington has done, because that GD Prevens has had no adverse effect. They've been studying it for a while now over the counter in Washington. It has been an over-the-top success. Why we're not doing that all throughout the country, I cannot understand.
Well, we don't have a problem with that.
Here, because it would have saved about like 12 of my friends.
Of course. We don't have unwanted pregnancies any other place in Washington State, do we?
Well, yeah, of course. But then why not just have it everywhere?
All
just
right.
In case people from Washington are
traveling. It doesn't go on in L.A. or Chicago or New York.
They might travel to the
States. That's true.
Yeah.
Some of those folks from Seattle may travel around and start populating. Good call, Drew. Cheyenne?
Yeah.
Is that it?
No, I have two questions.
All right.
Okay, the first one, a friend of mine just had a baby like 2 or 3 weeks ago.
There you go.
And there's a possibility of 12 different guys being the dad.
12?
Wow.
And,
some party.
Well,
I wish I was there.
Well, how did that happen?
Be 13.
She slept with 12 different guys in the same week, and it was the week she got pregnant.
Why did she do that?
And, like,
three of them were
married men, so.
Why did she do that?
I have no idea. I think it's a whole complex that she had with her dad, because I think he molested her and then
there you go.
He up and left and everything.
Thank you. Doesn't that make it simple when they just put it out there for us?
Well, you would have put it out there for her if she didn't put it out there for you.
Well, but it's nice when they...
Right. Listen, guys, the sad reality is all those loose chicks you're passing around the party and having a good time with, their dad or uncle passed them around when they were 9.
Or
that,
6.
That is the sad part of life.
There's
I mean,
no such thing as a woman that's just into sex like that.
Well, not 13 guys in a week.
Well, if that
9
were,
guys,
if
maybe.
That, if that were a guy on a spree?
Yeah. Well, that's why it's so out of hand with the gays. You know, this is, no one's watching the fort. You know, it's just guys. Hey, Cheyenne?
Yeah.
All right, so... She could use some of this Prevent stuff, right?
Yeah. She's trying to get pregnant again. Yeah.
What?
She's only 16. She just turned 16, like, a month ago.
What happened to this kid that was a product of the rapes or the multiple partner scene?
She still has him.
Oh, how old is he?
He's, like, 3 weeks old.
And she wants to get pregnant again.
She's
FBI.
She's going to trying within the next couple months.
You need, Adam, when you're in power, a new department of the FBI.
Yeah, kid control. I'm telling you.
Somebody needs to lock her up in a basement, I swear.
No, well, listen, Cheyenne, you're a friend. Why don't you do something, please?
I have. I've tried to talk her out of it.
Do more.
I'm trying to get with a married man.
And this is going
to,
like, cauterize her tubes, for Christ's sake. Forget about talking her out of it. Listen, these crazy broads are going to destroy this country one screwed-up kid at a time. It's dismantling this country. And they really are. I mean, how many screwed-up, incest victim 16-year-old moms can you have before this country just comes undone? I mean, what are those kids going to do? What are they, the doctors and lawyers of the future?
Well, that's exactly the point, the lawyers. Because, you know, what it comes down to is that, I won't blame the lawyers exclusively.
Go ahead. Drew hates lawyers.
No, if you don't have control over your own children, who do you have control of? So if the law is keeping people from being parents, and I mean people are too, I'm not certainly not blaming the system 100%, you know, but you need to be able to.
Listen, here's my feeling. If you can't handle kids, you shouldn't be having kids.
Yeah, but that's not human nature. Human nature.
I know it's not.
When you're 14,
it's not human nature to pay taxes either, to pull building permits. I'm sure
more
when you're
human nature than taking care of kids these days.
Well, I mean, put it this way: you just opened a restaurant, right? The Baccio Organico. It's in Vegas.
Baccio Organico? No, I'm kidding.
That's
yeah.
1020 Desert Inn.
You're right.
No.
The point is you had to go down the city. You had to pull some permits. You had to jump through a few hoops, right?
Sure.
But this chick who's 16 and already has a kid can go out and get knocked up again, and there's no permits to pull.
That's
there's
because
nothing
human
she has
beings
to clear.
Are basically, no matter how much civilization, when it hadn't been that long, if you think about the dinosaurs, we're animals. And so
right.
The animal thing is to reproduce.
But the one thing society is supposed to do is to help elevate us to a greater
help
good.
Help that work.
Right.
Out.
Yeah. Right.
A system. But we don't. You know, it's unfortunate.
We don't. If society doesn't help us do that, we ain't going to do that.
All right. Yeah. Speaking of being an animal, I got to take a crap.
Oh.
Okay.
Well, I have to take a piss. So
oh, do you?
Yeah.
I'll go number one then, and
you
I'll spare you that.
Swords?
Yeah, you want to go pee too? Come on, let's have a pee party.
Yeah, the racier play swords, because, you know, you can't win both ways.
All right, Chris Penn is here along with Tom Benson, who, Mike, don't do that. I'm going to wet right here. I swear to God, I'll short this mic out. The Florentine is the name of the new movie, and we'll take a break. We'll be back.
Loveline, Adam Carolla, and Dr. Drew. The phone number's 1-800-LOVE-191.
We'll be right back.
Loveline, exclusively on Tucson's New Rock. 92.1 KFMA.
Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That's Dr. Drew. Chris Penn is our guest tonight. He's working, or has produced, actually, a movie called The Florentine. I was handed a note that said it was executive produced by Francis Ford Coppola. Never heard of him. And some other guy named Jim Belushi. Two guys, up-and-comers.
Actually, Jim is an actor in We Missed Him Point Upon the Ensemble. Jim.
Yeah.
Jim plays a con man, Billy Belasco, and does a terrific job. It's really a unbelievable performance.
That's the voice of Tom Benson, the writer of the movie, by the way.
Actually, I co-wrote. I can't take all the credit.
I know. We talked about this.
He
wrote the movie.
He's writing a movie about you.
Oh, really? Ooh, yeah. He's a genius.
Damien Gray.
Along with my buddy Damien Gray.
Damien Gray wrote a play that Tom took and wrote a screenplay out of. Francis, I'm going to clarify everything. Just
all right,
make
go ahead,
it quick.
Because we got to see these guys.
Francis Coppola, who I made my first movie with as an actor called Rumblefish.
Right.
He has executive produced this, and this is my first movie as a producer, which is, you know, not only is it, what's that word?
What's the difference between executive produce and produce?
It's like a cycle. It's like a circle.
Cyclical.
Well, executive produce is producers, the people that came up. I mean,
the producers actually, they're the hands-on,
I'm
the
bad.
People that actually make the movie.
Right.
Francis, in his capacity, along with Cindy Cowan and Fred Fuchs up at American Zoetrope,
and Shelley Glasser,
kind of godfather the process.
They get
for
the money
you.
Together.
they get the money together, they make sure that you're protected as a filmmaker, that you have an opportunity to make a movie that you want to make, that you come in under budget, on schedule, and they kind of oversee that whole process, because, you know, when you're on there and you're shooting, you go on a 27-day shoot, you get $2-3 million, you can't run over, and they're the ones who kind of oversee the whole process with the bond company and what have you.
Michael Madsen and Virginia Madsen, of course, Chris Penn, Mary Stuart Masterson, Luke Perry, Jim Belushi, Tom Sizemore, Hal Holbrook, someone for everybody. I don't know if Luke,
say, who isn't in this,
Luke Perry and Hal Holbrook worked together too many times, but
I gotta say one thing.
Sure.
They're both, Hal is probably the performance of the whole movie. My favorite performance in the whole movie is Hal Holbrook. He's fantastic. But everybody in this movie worked for next to nothing. This movie was done for nothing. Nobody got anything. I mean, I've known, not to say they're friends, but I've known for many, many years, Bruce Springsteen, Bob Dylan, Tom Waits, Elvis Costello, I don't know, but we got music from all these people. Everybody gave these songs for nothing. All these actors worked for nothing. Francis Coppola worked for nothing. Fred Fuchs, Shelley Glatzer, and Cindy Callan, who financed the movie. Don't know if they're going to make their money back, but it's a hell of a movie, and we're all very proud of it. And so everybody did this because they loved this material. And that's the main thing.
That's a tribute to the writing.
Thank you.
Jason, you're 22. Oh, for Christ's sake. Jason, did you use the name Jason, or did you make up the name Jason?
Hello?
Yes, there you go.
Oh, sorry, I had to answer the line real quick.
There's another call.
Oh, all right.
Yeah, sorry about that. Okay, I'm 21, and I have been seeing, I'm letting it ring. 21, I've kind of been seeing this 17-year-old, and she won't get over, or she can't get over her first.
How long ago was she with the first?
They've been broken up for about, I'd say, maybe about a month, maybe.
Well, it's pretty quick for her to get over something. I mean, it takes about...
Is that her in the background, Jason?
No.
No, you have a kid?
No, that's my coworker's kid.
Oh, okay.
But, they've been breaking up, like, off and on, and...
Right.
And I've been interested in her, and...
Yeah.
Like,
you're too nice.
Forget about it, Jason.
You're the nice guy, right?
Yeah, I am the nice guy.
And he's the abusive guy, right?
Well, he's not really abusive, but yeah, I mean, she's like an emotional person.
Yeah.
And
he's dangerous.
Yeah, yeah. And I can't...
Yeah.
I listen to you guys all the time. You guys are, you guys are awesome.
Good, because we're going to give you some valuable advice.
And I try to give her advice that you've given in the past to other people.
No, we're going to give you some advice.
We're giving it to you.
Okay.
All right, so quiet down.
Okay.
It's not going to be easy. See, his problem is his name is Jason, not Duke
really.
Or Bo or Butch or something like that. All right, here's the deal. You have one shot with this chick. It's to lay down the law and then back off. You can't keep going along with her. She's going to yo-yo you up and down.
Okay.
You're pushover, and that's not exciting to her. You pose no challenge and no threat. Do you understand?
So what can I do to...
You have to stand strong. That's your only shot.
Yeah, Chris.
I mean, he's also
Chris, yeah.
I tell you what, where do you live, Jason?
By the way, Chris, you don't have to raise your hand or anything. Just go right ahead.
But last time I was a little bit forward.
No, you were
great. We enjoyed it.
Where do you live, Jason?
In Vegas?
No. Huh?
Arizona.
Arizona?
Yeah, Prescott.
Go to Lake Havasu,
yeah.
With a couple of buddies.
Uh-huh.
Don't call her for a couple of weeks. And, give her your pager number. Let her page you about six or seven times. And then the eighth time, call her back.
Well, see, that's another thing. I mean, she still goes out and does things with this guy, but they're not together.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? If she doesn't page you that many times, then dump her.
I see no way that he gets anything out of this.
Complete pushover.
Yeah. Well, not just that he's even a pushover. It's that she is... not over in any way of that relationship. I mean, I don't care who the guy is. She's not interested. She's obsessively involved with that first guy. And that guy is the abusive, dangerous guy that she needs. But even another abusive, dangerous guy won't replace the fantasy she has about this first one.
Here is the bottom line for these situations. You have one choice and two options. Your one choice, and I shouldn't say that, two possibilities from this one choice. You got to back off and play it cool. Okay, now the two things that could happen is, A, she could wake up and come back to you, or B, she could forget all about you. Either way, you saved some face by backing off, and there's not a damn thing you could have done because you're chasing her now, and all you're getting is a runaround.
Well, it's the same thing with the Havasu story.
That's right. Chris put it much better with the Lake Havasu thing. I was just trying to save him from heading out to the lake. Ryan?
Yeah. First of all, I'm coming from Springfield, Missouri, the same place as that chick that had slept with 13 guys in the same week. Yeah, and you guys could do a whole show just on Springfield for about a week. This is about the most messed up place in the world.
Evidently.
Anyway, basically I just had a question about...
Not to disappoint us, Ryan, what's your question?
Just had a question about something I've been arguing for a long time about is what determines the size of penis? I mean, you guys were talking about black guys and Italians and stuff like that earlier, and I've been arguing for the white man for a while, and I was just kind of wondering what it was that determines that.
They got to open a movie theater there in Springfield.
I'm not sure.
Are too busy humping and talking about penis size.
I'm not trying to understand.
You know what?
Question.
It's the same thing that determines the size of your big toe.
That's right. Your genes.
It's your genes.
But your genes determine everything. I mean, what is it he's asking?
Let me explain the. Let me help with the myth of the black man for a second here. There's a couple of things. Yes, the black man's penis is slightly larger because the black man comes from a hotter area where the appendages are longer. You see those guys walking around in Mozambique, they got arms down to here. They all look like a minute bull.
It's a way of dissipating heat.
Right.
Yeah.
And then the guys who come from the cold places,
they're
big and round guys.
That's right.
Lots of hair on them.
Yes.
All right, but another reason the black man's penis looks bigger is two reasons. A, It appears bigger because when a bodybuilder is training for a competition, there's two things he does besides lifting weights. Shaves his body clean, and he suns himself. He gets tan. You never see any albino guys out there posing down. You have white guys that almost look black. They're so tan because the darkness in the skin really shows off the definition. So if you have a penis that's pale, pink, and white, it ain't going to look as big as the same size penis that's black. It's going to look more muscular and more defined. That's number two. Number three is the only black penis many white men see are in porn movies. And they don't let black guys with small penises into porn movies. It doesn't work out.
Yeah, but that doesn't count for white girls.
No, I know, but it helps perpetuate the myth. The only white people that see black penis see it in a porn movie, and they're not going to hire a black guy with a small dick. They hire guys with a big penis. It perpetuates the myth, plus the definition and everything look better. You take a 150-pound black man and a 150-pound white man, you tell them to both take their shirts off, the black guy looks more muscular, right? Well, drop his pants. The penis is going to look bigger, too. All right. I've made my argument for the white man.
Thank you.
We'll take
you
a break.
I felt very proud of that.
Thank you.
From Springfield, you know, that should make you feel a lot better.
We'll take a little break. Chris Penn is here, and we'll be back after this.
This is Loveline.
Loveline will be right back.
Loveline. We'll take a quick 10-second affiliate station identification, and we'll be back with more Loveline in just 10 seconds.
This is Loveline on
radio station.
This is Tucson's New Rock, 92.1 KFMA, Green Valley, Tucson.
It is Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. This is Dr. Drew. Chris Penn is our guest tonight. Tom Benson has joined Chris. Tom is the co-writer of the movie The Florentine. Chris stars and produces this movie. Michael Madsen's in it, Virginia Madsen, Chris Penn, as I've mentioned. Mary Stuart Masterson, Luke Perry, Jim Belushi, Tom Sizemore, and Hal Holbrook round out the cast. And there's others as well, but I just highlighted the notables. Now, let me get this straight again. It premieres on Monday at the Directors Guild, correct?
Correct.
And it will then get into a wider, because there weren't a lot of parts of the country, it will theoretically be coming to a theater near you.
Yeah, look for your local art house movie theater, because it's, you know, it's a small movie, it's an independent film, it's not going to be at the the Cineplex.
You never know. I mean, there's movies that have done that.
Sure.
I mean, you know, Full Monty and lots of other movies like that have started off small and gained some momentum.
Oh, well, that's later. Talking about opening.
Yeah, I'm talking about down the road a little. For those of you who are like in Springfield. Because movies like this, they open in L.A. and New York, and then they start sort of bleeding into the rest of the country, depending on how they do in L.A. and New York, right? Yeah.
They tear them out, they platform them out, and you'll open and...
Hey, Adam, we just finished doing an interview for that Sleepless in Seattle DVD.
Yes.
We're going to be part of the new Sleepless in Seattle DVD, I guess, right?
Right.
And one of the things we said was that we never generate discussions. We never bring up a topic that generates further discussion in our shows.
Right.
Well, tonight you've got a couple going right now, so let's go to calls here.
I do?
Yep.
What is it?
One is about Springfield, another is about racial genitalia.
Oh, Christ. Jennifer?
Yes?
You're 24. What's going on?
I'm so hacked off. Everybody hates Springfield, Missouri.
Hacked off. I like that.
I'm hacked.
I hacked off last night when I got home from work, and I'm planning on hacking again, possibly on the ride home. Thank you.
Really, though, I mean, it's not a bad place to live. I grew up here. I spent a year in St. Louis from here, and I came back because, I mean, it's just people here are a lot nicer. Yeah, it's slower and it's quieter, but that's such a bad thing.
All right. We're all for Springfield. Okay?
I was just in St. Louis on Friday.
You were?
Friday, yeah.
Yeah, but you said Springfield was a dump when you got back.
I didn't go to Springfield.
Okay. All right, Jennifer.
St. Louis is a dump.
All right. Sorry. No more hacking off.
They got
that
beautiful train station, though. God, that was spectacular.
All right, Drew, let's not turn this into a travel show.
All right,
show.
Let's go.
Who cares
let's
if
go.
Springfield, Missouri is getting a
Keep
bad
going.
Rap, you
Keep
jackass?
Going. Let's go.
Driving me nuts. Rachel.
Yes.
You're 21.
Yes, I am.
What's going on?
Nothing. I was just listening to what you guys were talking about.
About the penis size?
Yes.
Yeah.
How you were saying that a black man's penis, just because he's dark, is more defined and it looks larger. That is so not true.
So what is true?
Well, from the experience I've had, most of the black men have turned out larger than the white men that I've been with.
So the penis is bigger on a black man.
And that's by nothing to do with looks or nothing. It's all.
I understand. Yeah, she's not actually looking at it. She's experiencing
it. You can tell. Well, you're traumatizing the poor kid in the background.
She said you could tell it's traumatizing the poor kid. That's my nephew. And
yeah. Yeah, your aunts had all kinds of schlong. Black, white, Italian,
you know what?
Chinese. I had it
Go
all.
Go with what's good for you, baby.
My cousin said, Adam, your show traumatizes her kid.
Well, tell him not to listen.
Don't play it around the kids.
Oh, he's too little. He doesn't understand. He doesn't know what we're talking about.
All right. So you're here to say that the black penis is bigger.
Yes.
Okay, good.
I am.
I'm glad. I got some. All right, Rachel.
Yes.
Thank you. All right, so we've cleared up a few myths. Springfield is not a dump. Black penises are bigger than white.
I think we've established that most Americans, it's going to be a lot better off if men were African-American and gay.
Right.
That would be the utopia.
They'd have large penises and they'd recycle. Is that what you're saying?
It would just be a better place.
They'd dress better. Okay. Kayla.
Hello.
You're 24. What's going on?
I got a question for Dr. Drew.
Yes, ma'am.
Is it possible for a woman to be allergic to cum?
Yeah, it is, actually. Why? What's the story here?
Well, it seems that when I'm with somebody and we're using condoms, everything is fine. But as soon as we stop, I start to have problems. And then I go to my gynecologist and she'll say that there's nothing wrong with me.
This is the same man or different people?
Different people, different men.
How many times has this happened?
Three.
But have you ever been with the same guy with and without a condom?
Uh-huh.
And it happens.
Happens without the condom.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's hard. It's not really an allergy.
What Drew was asking, wasn't he?
I know. It's not really an allergy necessarily, because you would expect the allergy to be unique to a single person, not sort of everybody's stuff.
I think I may be allergic to everyone's sperm.
However,
one time in camp, I don't want to get into it, but I tell you, I don't want to think about it.
However, you got to understand that that things can cause the vaginal environment to change. When you're obviously with the condom, there's nothing left behind. And there could be bacterial overgrowth. There could be just vaginitis.
Well, wouldn't that be allergic then?
No.
Well, it's not traditionally allergic,
allergy is a specific kind of reaction.
All right, but she's a layman. I mean, what she's saying is she has an adverse reaction to semen.
Well, she knows that.
What's the symptom?
Do I have to get into that?
Yeah.
It's sort of like a yeast infection.
Right. It burns and you discharge, that sort of thing.
What if it gets on you?
Elsewhere.
Nothing.
Nothing.
No.
Well, there's your answer.
Unless it gets on my hand or something.
Oh, yeah.
A rash in my hand or anything.
You don't do that?
No.
All right. So, Drew, what do you do with this?
I'm maybe nothing. She's seen the gynecologist. There's no specific bacterial overgrowth. It's just a matter of learning to manage this. I mean, it's not as though you have discomfort all the time, is it?
Excuse me?
It's not as though you have discomfort all the time when you're not using a condom.
Not every day, but...
What if the guy doesn't have an orgasm inside of you?
Like, when does that happen? Never.
I don't know. The hell do I know? Have the guy pull out, like in the porn movies. Is that the way it works? The guy goes, oh, come on, baby. Oh, yeah. And then you, like, go nuts and start rubbing yourself.
That's because he only gets paid for the cum spot.
Oh, really?
Jeez. Or a shot.
That spot will work. All right, Kayla, tell the guy to pull out, would you? What, are you trying to get pregnant?
Have you seen Boogie Nights?
No, I'm not trying to get pregnant. I'm just trying to figure this out.
All right, but why are you letting guys come inside of you?
What are you using for birth control?
The pill.
Well, forget about birth control. What are you using to prevent disease? I mean, this is not even safe.
Whoops. Your mic just went off.
To prevent disease?
Yeah, all right. Why do we get the dumb ones on this show all night long? Kayla, have the guy pull out or put the condom on.
Hey, Chris is right. That's if safe sex is going to be practiced, you know, it's like wearing a seatbelt. You got to do it all the time.
Right. Erica.
Yes.
You're 17.
Yes.
What's going on?
Well, me and my boyfriend have been going out about 6 months, and I recently lost my virginity to him. But I'm afraid that I could be pregnant. My mom, she's freaking out about it. She's worried about it. She thinks I am. I don't know how.
How old's your mom?
36.
Perfect.
Perfect. Yeah.
She was 18 when she got pregnant with you.
Mm-hmm.
You got any older brothers or sisters?
No, I'm the oldest.
All right. So, yeah, your mom is doing some projection, right? I mean, she got pregnant kind of young, right?
Same way, probably.
Yeah, well, she was married when she got pregnant.
Now, let me understand
you buy that, right?
Let me understand this. You had intercourse once with a guy?
No, several times, but...
And why weren't you using birth control?
I was there for a while, but the pills started making me sick. And so I was...
Yeah. Well, listen, I'll tell you why. Because her mom got knocked up when she was 18, and now Erica's going to get knocked up when she was 18. That's the way this crappy ball of world works. I mean, that's just the way people are. Sad, but true. Hey, Erica?
Yeah?
How long ago did this happen?
I last slept with him probably about 3 weeks ago.
Yeah. And have you got a pregnancy test?
No, I haven't, but I had my period, and I don't know. My eating habits and everything have changed, though, really bad.
Oh, but listen, and who the hell knows what I do day to day? You know what I mean?
What are you talking about, Erica?
You had your period, right?
You had your period?
No, but that's what I was wondering.
When did you have your period, Erica?
Hmm?
When did you have your period?
Probably, like, 7 days, 2 weeks ago, after it. 7 days after I slept with him.
Okay.
Well, that certainly makes the probability of pregnancy a lot worse. You absolutely could have a period and be pregnant. You also can bleed in the first trimester and seem like a period. Go get a pregnancy test.
And listen, all you numbskulls out there, you know, are you that hell-bent on screwing? Does everyone have to outdo their parents in the screw-up category?
Wait,
you know,
Chris has like, something to say.
Mom, well, write it down, Chris, because that's what Chris does. Your mom was knocked up at 18, so you're going to get knocked up at 17. I don't know. What's going on? Well, I used some protection, but it didn't work. I think I'm pregnant. Who knows? I'll wait and see if we do. Wait till the kid pokes his head out of the vagina to really make sure we're pregnant. Meanwhile, go on smoking pot and drinking like a fish. Please, all you idiots, take some control of your life. Why is everyone so hell-bent on screwing their life up? What's the note say there, Chris?
You didn't know that you could bleed? Yeah, but bleeding in the first trimester is very common, and it's...
Well, it's like doing a radio show with Harpo. Would you speak up into that microphone?
No, it's like Marcel Marceau here.
All right, you guys have asked for it. You're going to get a Toyota. They'll make that Infiniti.
Drew, or caller Drew, you're 25.
Yes, I know this is going to sound like an extremely juvenile question. It's just based on my limited experience with men and relationships, but...
Why is your experience so limited?
I've chosen to not go out with too many people. I've limited, my getting into relationships and things of this nature. And
how come?
Because I feel that men only want one thing, and I...
Well, we don't mind a blowjob every once in a while. Is that what she's talking about?
I'm sorry?
All right, Drew, let Drew ask her question, please.
Okay. Well, I was involved in a relationship it was very intense, and I started behaving like totally out of my character, and I fell pretty hard, and I just wanted to know from male perspective, how is it that a guy can totally go into it and very intensely and then just slam on the brakes pretty much from out of nowhere?
Fear.
When were the brakes slammed? What point in the relationship? The day after you had intercourse with him?
No. He decided it was done when I started saying, well, I started sensing that he just wasn't interested. He wasn't showing an interest.
Okay.
How long were you in the relationship with him?
6 weeks. And which to me, seriously, it's out of my character.
At what point did you start having sex with him?
Second week, which is even weirder.
Not that weird.
Well, for me, it's weird.
Okay, well, listen, you're with a guy who's either not interested in you or not really interested in a relationship.
He was interested in what you expect guys to be interested in. You cast a play properly.
Yes.
You found the person to play that role that you expected him to play, and he's done it just right.
And let me just say this in a more philosophical note. All you women out there who are convinced that guys are only interested in one thing, you're magically only going to find guys who want to bang you. All people out there who are convinced that Mexicans are one way are only going to meet Mexicans that are one way, and who think blacks are one way are only going to meet those people. All the people that are convinced certain people are a certain way or certain genders are a certain way are just going to meet those people. You're creating that.
Well, I'm sorry. I have another.
People are scared of mice.
Related to this, what if I wanted?
I think mice are a certain way.
What if I wanted to work things out? I mean, would it? Is it?
No.
You can't work it out with him because he was one of those guys you already cast in your little play. But you can work things out on your own and then not cast that guy next time you have a casting session.
You have a sense that guys need to be abusive and you are distant or emotionally unavailable, and you found that guy.
Okay.
And there's something going on with caller Drew, yes. By the way, because she was set up for this in the first place. I'm guessing your dad, was your dad a philanderer? Did he play around? Were abandoned? What did he do?
Yeah.
All that.
What did he do?
He was unfaithful.
Yeah.
Ooh.
So, magical. Oh.
Drew, scrape me up off the floor.
Shocking.
My God, talk about luck.
Yeah. How did you...
Wild guess.
Yeah.
Wild.
That's just out of the blue.
One in a million shot.
Drew, of course, that's what your dad was like, and that's, of course, why you search for that kind of person, even though that's the person you believe you're trying to avoid.
Right.
You've got to solve those problems of childhood by recasting dad and making him good this time.
Angela.
Hi.
Hey, you're 22.
Yes.
We're on with Chris Penn.
Hi, Chris. Hi, Tom. Hi, Drew. You're a stud. Adam, you're funny.
Thank you. I don't know. Chris got up and took a leak or something. I mean, he's a very erratic guy, this Chris.
Okay. I was wondering, I'm a virgin, and I was wondering if there is some way to make sex not hurt before I have it. I
suppose you can have your hymen sort of surgically opened up beforehand, but it's really going to be uncomfortable, I suspect, anyway.
Hey, you don't have a hymen at 22,
and at 22,
do you?
That's what I was going to say. You have one, you know?
Well, I don't know.
Well, don't you know?
I assume that I do, but I don't know.
Not necessarily.
How can she check, Drew? What are you telling me to do? Her finger. Okay. You use your finger and put it where? Drew said in your ass. That doesn't make sense.
But I was wondering because a year ago I tried to use like a tampon and it like got stuck like halfway and I thought I was going to die.
Yeah, that's probably.
And I had to like yank it out and I was like traumatized.
Yeah, that's probably the hymen.
You know, the black tampons are bigger.
No, they're not.
All right.
And for the person who said Springfield was the bomb, Springfield is a cesspool of incest and ignorance and
St. Louis. Really? What famous people are from Springfield, Missouri?
Isn't like Abe Lincoln or somebody from Springfield?
Kathleen Turner and John Goodman, I think. I don't know.
Oh, really? Are you from Springfield, too?
No, I go to school down here.
Oh.
St. Louis.
All right. What school do you go to?
Southwest Missouri State.
Oh, go Screaming Badgers. What's the mascot?
The bear.
Oh, the bear. That's good. That's a solid mascot. Oh, yeah. You know, Drew went to school. His mascot was the Lord Jeffs.
Yes.
Are you kidding me?
Oh, yes.
Some kind of powdered wig and a robe? The guy who invented malaria or
germ warfare?
Jesus Christ. Just play it safe and go with a bear. That's smart. Everyone's got the bear, but that's fine. All right, Angela, God bless you for being a virgin at the ripe old age of 22. Chris Penn has now re-entered the studio. He's just...
Woke me up.
Knocked Dr. Drew.
Yeah, like Joe Pesci and, in Raging Bull. He just whacked through at the door. He's come back in. He's finding his way to a seat.
Any question?
There we go. James.
Jay, what's the question?
James, you're 15.
Yeah.
What's going on?
Well, I've been thinking about piercing one of my nipples, and I've heard that... if you do that, you can lose sensitivity in them.
Yeah.
You can.
You don't really need your nipples as a guy, though, do you, Drew?
No.
I don't mind a little nipple play.
You also don't need
play,
them pierced.
You don't need them pierced either.
Or a tattoo. I would suggest not doing it.
Okay.
Yeah. Hey, listen, James.
Yeah?
You have a lot of stupid ideas when you're younger. You know what I mean? Like, I wanted to build a submarine. You know, now you want to get a tattoo and your nipples pierced. Thank God they didn't really have these options when I was 15, or I'd probably be walking around with a hole in my nipple.
You want to know the only reason to get your nipple pierced? If you're starving, you're in the middle of the, you know, mountains, and you need to go fishing, you got a hook. You can get a stick and fish.
Other than that, James, there's no reason. So don't bother with that. All right?
Yeah.
This is not going to help you. All right?
All right.
Oh, but Anna, but it looks so cool.
Yeah, you really look like a winner with that nipple piercing. To me, on women as well, but on guys especially, it's a little weird. I mean, it's a little sort of sexually jumbled. I don't find that attractive. To me, the additions to the anatomy are never attractive. Mm-hmm. You know, the chicks with the, you know, holes in their nose and the navel, the piercings. Look, either you're good-looking or you're not. If you're good-looking, don't mess around. Okay, breast implants, that could work. All right, thanks, Drew. I'm glad you brought up that alternative viewpoint.
I won't even go there.
You don't like the breast implants?
No, I don't.
No, I'm not a huge fan of them either, but... as opposed to what they were before the implant, I might be for that. You know what I mean? I mean, there's a lot.
Though? I mean, I'm just asking how.
How what?
How could you be for the unnatural augmentation rather than the natural? What was there?
Unless
it was deformed, or, you know, there was some kind of real medical problem.
Right.
That was fixed with plastic surgery. How could you prefer, you know, the augmentation rather than the natural?
Well, I'll answer that this way. There's, this mic drives me nuts. Oh, this Westwood 2 is such
it's
a
not the mic.
Goddamn
it's not the mic. It's your headphones.
I know. Here's my point. There's many things that women do for men. Plucking eyebrows, painting fingernails, putting makeup on, you get your teeth bonded or whitened, you get your hair dyed. There's many things that women do that work out pretty good. I mean, let's face it, if you saw most women and they didn't pluck their eyebrows, they didn't put any makeup on, and they didn't brush their teeth, it wouldn't be a real pretty sight. It really wouldn't.
You're absolutely right.
The breast augmentation is sort of a extension of that. Maybe it's going a little far, but it's an extension.
Well, exactly. That's the only thing. Let me just touch it this way. When you put makeup on, you can wipe it off. When you pluck eyebrows, they grow back.
Right.
When you do breast augmentation and you die and you get buried in your coffin, your skeleton dies and the skin dissolves and plastic bags are sitting in your rib cage.
Yeah, it's Drew's
it's
brought this
disgusting.
Up.
Yeah.
No, I think in a few thousand years when they dig up the 20th century man, they'll find the female bodies with these plastic sacks lying on the chest and think, oh, some sort of ritual. Or they must have laid the sacks there as some sort of offering to the gods, because they will never imagine that they were inserted during life.
True. They'll be watching some DVD porn and know exactly what's going on. And let me just say this, Chris. Let me tell you what my plan is. My plan is to hump them before they die. That... It doesn't always work out that way, but that's my tentative plan.
It better.
It, not always. I can't make any guarantees. All right, we'll take a break. We'll be back.
Oh, yeah. Everybody now.
Yes, I will be right back.
Loveline will be right back.
Exclusively on Tucson's New Rock, 92.1 KFMA.
Hey, y'all, it is the fabulous Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Chris Penn is our guest tonight. And he's got himself a movie coming out. What the hell did I do, Wes? Oh, I doodled over the title. Florentine. The Florentine is the name of the movie. It'll be out at least at the out here in L.A. on Monday. You can see that. You can call this number if you want to see it. 1-888-386-8497. That number again, Drew?
888-386-8497.
Very professional. You ready to get back to the phones?
Yeah, I'm ready.
All right. Jamie.
Hi, everybody.
You're 18. What's happening?
I am. When I was about 5, my sister was about 4, we kind of, like, had sexual, like, experiences with each other, kind of.
Right.
And I like, remember it, like, really good. I've never spoken to her about it now, but I would think that since I remember it, she would remember it. And I think I was the one who initiated everything. And now, like, my family and I, we think she's gay. And I was wondering if that had anything to do with, like...
This is you and your sister. You're 5 and she's 4.
Yeah, I think those are the ages.
Uh-huh. And you think you could have turned her into a lesbian?
Or if that had anything to do with that.
It's hard to say.
Yeah, and we'll say no just so you can sleep. I mean, unless she makes any real money on the PGA Tour, in which case you got to get in for a cut. You know, one episode, was it one episode or did you guys...
Oh, it was like, my mom used to watch that soap opera, All My Children, and we used to pretend like we were the people on the soap opera, and it happened, it went on, like, many times.
Did an adult ever do anything to you before that happened?
No.
Have you been victimized in any way since then?
No, and that's, like, why you always, like, talk about that, but...
Well, so what makes you think this wasn't just usual kind of play, a sort of experimentation?
It maybe was, and then...
Because it doesn't... Was it explicitly sexualized, or was it just sort of...
No.
No, see?
No, he didn't... She's lesbian because she's lesbian.
Right, right.
Okay.
That's what I think.
And would that be considered, like, me molesting her?
No, because it has to be sexualized within...
You were 5. molesting her.
5-year-olds do molest 5-year-olds, but only after an adult has abused one of them sexually, because otherwise 5-year-olds aren't directed specifically sexually.
Yeah.
It's just sort of touching and experimentation and exploration.
Right.
Which is different than, you know, a directed interaction towards sex.
Right. Yeah, so, Jamie, don't take any responsibility for this. You're fine. She's fine. She's a lesbian. Everything's good.
Okay.
All right? How old is she? 17?
Yeah, she's 17 now.
Yeah.
And
our
conclusion is mostly based on the fact that you're fine in your relationships.
Right.
So you would have had to have had some sort of experience also for this to be...
It's interesting, though, she came out to her family fairly young.
No, well, she
didn't.
Hasn't, like, come out, but we think that she is.
Oh, you suspect she is. Why is that?
Well, her whole entire life, she's been, like, a tomboy, and now all of her friends are, like... They're older, but they're all lesbians that have already come out. Those are, like, her only friends, and she...
It's usually a pretty good inclination.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah.
All right, but she hasn't come out officially.
No.
All right, listen, Jamie, you sound like a real good person. Don't worry about it.
Okay.
You're fine. Okay?
Thanks, and you guys are totally cool. I love you so much, and you're so funny, and I cannot believe I actually got through on the phone, and I'm just, like... I try to call, like, all the time, and I listen to you guys every night.
Call us again.
What do you think of Springfield, Missouri?
I have never been there.
Where are you calling from?
I'm calling from San Diego.
Okay. Jamie?
Yeah.
Take care of yourself. Anthony?
Yeah.
You're 20.
Yeah.
What's going on?
Not much. I just wanted to thank you guys for some good advice you gave me when you guys first started your TV show.
Mm-hmm.
I had a question about, sex with my girlfriend. And I was telling you guys that we both wanted to finish school and stuff like that, and you guys kind of, I think it was you that said you need to spend time in the dojo or something like that. And I just wanted to thank you guys for your advice, because now, you know, I got...
Sounds like great advice, Adam.
A steady job going, and she's still in school, and we're married now.
Good.
And I just wanted to thank you guys.
What I mean by spend time in the dojo?
I think you were talking about masturbation.
Oh.
So, because we had gotten real close a couple times, and,
Oh, I see. You didn't have sex.
Right.
You wanted to have sex.
Right. And it could have ended up into something else, but now...
Right.
We're very happy, and, you know, I got my career going, and...
Back when you were 16, 17, right?
Well, I was 17 at the time.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to thank you guys and Chris. I just wanted to tell you I'm a big fan of yours, too.
Well, thank you.
And thanks a lot, guys.
All right. Well, there you go.
How bizarre is that now that guys we talked to when they were 16, 17, when we started television, are now 20?
Yeah, that's weird. Yeah. For Christ's sake. How long have we been doing that show?
3 years.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh,
is that bizarre?
Without a raise.
Uh-oh.
Oh, God damn, are we getting raped on that show? Jesus Christ. We got to do something about that, Drew.
Our viewers and callers have become adults in the time we've been on it, and we're still...
Yeah, we're still getting
You're
paid
still
kitty
children.
Wedges.
We're still radio guys.
Still horrible. Guys from humanity. Radio. Oh, the amount of money I should be paid for the amount of genius I possess. Right, Drew?
Yeah, right, Hannah.
Thanks. Christine?
Yes.
You're 23.
And by the way, do you notice Greg Kilborn tonight was suggesting that I should be embarrassed that I get paid the same as you?
Oh, he was?
That's what he said. Huh. He said you're a doctor for... You're going to say him as Anna.
No, he was just busting your balls, Kilborn. What's he know? We're going to be on... Craig Kilborn's show tonight, by the way, if you were up and turn the TV on. And I'm going to watch because I think that starts at 12:30 out here, right?
I think.
Yeah, I'll just be getting home.
Yeah.
Right, we're going to watch it.
Yeah.
Christine?
Yes?
I wish I knew how to work my VCR to tape it. What's going on?
Well, I was just wondering. Somebody just called not too long ago asking about piercings and... if it could decrease sensitivity, I wanted to ask why it might increase it, because that was my experience.
Where is the piercing?
I have both my nipples pierced.
Most people we've talked to say it does increase sensitivity, at least initially, but then it tends to get less.
Because I've had them for about 2 years now.
And it stays increased?
And yeah, I haven't noticed it. I mean, at first, you know, it's like this new foreign thing. So when you first get it done, it's, well, you're walking around with erect nipples all the time. But, you know, that's a little different. But I wouldn't say it significantly decreased from prior to the piercing.
Well, aren't you, is it that the sensitivity is more increased, or is it just that you got things hanging from your nipples 24/7 now, and you're much more nipple aware than you were before?
You see, I wouldn't say I'm more nipple aware now because, like, it's...
Well, you're certainly more nipple friendly.
Well, I've had them for about 2 years, so it's gotten past the point where, you know, I've noticed it all the time, and it's just kind of a part of me at this point.
Consider yourself lucky. Really, because we hear people talking about decreased sensitivity with time.
Okay.
It's not necessarily the case, but we hear about it.
Well, and time doesn't necessarily mean 21 to 23. Time could mean 21 to 40.
Yeah, which...
You know what I mean? I mean, the body doesn't turn over overnight. I mean, does it, Drew? I mean, you, when you talk about stuff, whether it's smoking or drinking or nipple piercing, aren't you sort of talking about stuff that happens over a 20-year period, not a 2-year period?
As far as what?
I don't understand. You're listening to me.
Part of what you said,
I'm talking about...
Any big major change physically... Can take
long-term.
A long time.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Right. I mean, what I mean is just because your nipples are not desensitized in the
right.
first 24 months does
right.
not mean that 10 years, 20 years, 30 years down the road,
right.
they won't, right?
That is correct.
What's it called when the hole that you put in yourself sort of just turns into a hole? What is that process called?
Epithelialization.
That's what I like. I want to epithelialize myself.
Epithelialize.
Epithelialize? Oh, now you're screwed. You say it one more time, you'll never know what it means, and you'll always screw it up. That's it. You're done. Your next lecture, they're all going to laugh. Amanda.
Yes.
You're 23.
I am.
What's going on?
I'm just started a relationship. I've been in a relationship for about a month and a half now. My boyfriend is in a band, and they're out on tour right now, which is, you know, a problem in its own, but
yeah, I'm sure he's not screwing around with any groupies.
I don't think he is, because they don't have groupies, but
was he in a polka band?
Reggae, actually.
Yeah, some stoners that hang out.
Yeah, but anyways, I'm still, like, before I met him, I was really involved in I did a lot of chat rooms and a lot of cyber sex.
Uh-huh.
I wasn't actually having cyber sex. I just kind of like typed it, you know, so the other person could get off.
Right.
But I can't stop doing it. And I'm a little worried because I don't want to, you know, I'm trying not to think that I'm cheating on him, but I'm not sure why I can't stop doing that.
Well,
I don't think he'll care. Do you, Adam?
No, he's in a reggae band. Right. He doesn't even know your first name. He's just smoking spleef and sort of hanging out.
No, he is actually, he is an incredible guy. He's from another country. He's never taken a drink in his life, never smoked a cigarette in his life.
You better hope the guy's in the band, but he's smoking weed, right?
No.
They'll toss his ass right out of the band if they find that out.
They're different, though. They're not like Jamaican reggae.
They're a Christian reggae band.
No. Actually, they're from Nigeria, but...
He's Nigerian?
He's Nigerian, yeah.
Does he have a big penis?
Actually, no, but...
Oh,
okay.
That's smart.
Anyways, but...
I shouldn't say.
Yeah, go ahead.
Go ahead, Chris.
I mean, I like Nigerians. I've got a lot of Nigerian friends, to be honest with you, but...
You don't have any Nigerian friends.
Yes, I do, actually, for the boxing gym. I've got a bunch of them.
Oh, okay, all right.
I'll buy that.
All I'm saying is Nigerians are very charming, but they're always up to something.
I don't
mean in a bad way. I like them.
All right. They're charming folks that are up to something. But it's not he that's up to something. It's she, Amanda's the one who's carrying on with the cyber sex. Are you masturbating to this at all?
No.
No.
Making other guys do it.
You're just getting other guys off.
Yeah.
What is... And there's a feeling of power in that, huh?
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
A bit, yeah.
Yeah. All right.
That she's needed to be...
Why don't you look into that feeling and forget so much about the cheating aspect, but why you got to have that feeling?
Remember that if things that were traumatizing as a child become sexualized in adulthood, in adolescence.
Yeah.
And even it can be even sort of skewed in early adolescence. It can come out in peculiar ways. But whatever happens, suddenly... The brain turns it into a sexual issue.
Right.
It's very strange, but, you know, it does.
All right, we're going to take a break. So, what have we learned? The black man usually has a bigger penis, and you can't trust them Nigerians. They're what? I mean, they're charming people, but let's face it, those Nigerians, they'll steal a kernel of corn off a bingo card, those Nigerians. You cannot trust them at all.
Chris said anyway.
As soon as you turn your back, oh, corn to Chris. All right, so... We are going to take a little break, and we'll be back after this.
The phone number for Loveline is 1-800-LOVE-191. Loveline, I'll be right back.
Hey, I'm Dr. Drew.
And I'm Adam Carolla, and you're listening to Loveline on 92.1 KFMA.
Your construction...
Loveline on 92.1 KFMA. Hey there, y'all. It's Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. It's Dr. Drew, Chris Penn, and Tom Benson are both here. The Florentine is the name of the movie. I got to get out of the habit of doodling over the title of things that I need to read on the air, Drew. I want you to stop me next time
I'll
you see me
you
do that. Ginger?
Yes.
You're 23.
Yeah.
What's going on?
Well, I've been struggling with deciding on whether to tell my parents that I'm bisexual.
Why is that an important thing to tell your parents?
Well... A couple weeks ago, my mom asked me basically if I was a lesbian because I do have a lot of gay friends. And I evaded the question, you know, basically put it off on her. You know, I asked her, you know, would it make you feel better if I wasn't? And, you know, she was just very... My parents are really religious, so the mere...
See what they get?
Yeah, even the mere idea would probably get me disowned. And
so why would you tell them?
Because I feel guilty about it.
No, you're pissed at them.
You want to let them have it.
Give it to them good. Trying to ram that religion up your ass. This will show them. This is their worst nightmare, right?
Yeah, basically.
All right. Now you're going to get them.
But I don't want to do that, really, you know?
Well, then don't tell them.
Then don't tell them. I mean, listen, where's your dad? Is he around?
My parents are still married. Yeah, they've been married for 34 years.
But he was a little rough, huh? Dad.
Yeah.
This is it. You got to get back. Got to get him.
It's payback time.
Yeah.
Well, now it's...
Oh, yes.
Yeah, it is. It is. I mean, you have some anger toward your dad, right?
No, not really. Oh, I love my dad.
He was a little rough, though, wasn't he?
Well, he was in the Marines, and so, you know, it's just that military mentality.
Oh, it's not his fault. Not his fault. It's just his military mentality.
Well, it's his drill sergeant,
yeah,
really.
Just because he smacked me out, threw me across the room when I was flying.
No, not at all. My dad was not abusive at all.
Well, what did he do?
Nothing. I mean, I'm not angry with my father.
When you say he was rough.
Well, you know, just rough around the edges, not really.
Not physically rough.
He was strict.
No. Strict guy.
And religious.
Very strict, yes. Very.
And very religious.
Yes.
And for some reason, the religion didn't really take with you?
It did, but that's just another story, something that I have to deal with on my own as far as the guilt over that.
Okay, so you don't have any issues with your parents. You love them very much.
Well, I love my dad a lot. My mom just rides on me a lot. You know, there's just a lot of, she expects me to be perfect, stuff like that.
All right, but here's our point. Usually, and there's nothing wrong with being honest with your family, but usually when you're hell-bent on telling them something that you know is going to flip them out, it's a little bit of payback for something that they did.
You wouldn't want to do it otherwise. If you know they're going to disown you, with it, to use your own words, why would you create that kind of pain for everybody? Unless you needed them to know the totality of who you are for some reason, and you were prepared to accept the consequences, and you know that it would probably terminate your relationship with them. I mean, otherwise,
you're bi too. I mean, hell, you're not even lesbian, not full time.
Right. Part-time occupation.
All right, so listen. Wait, why do you gotta... Don't tell them. God knows I don't tell my parents anything. Drew, you don't tell your folks anything.
What's the point? Most
Drew's parents think he's a dentist, for Christ's sake.
Most young adults do not talk to their parents about their sexual activity.
Hey, Ginger?
Yeah.
Yeah, act like the rest of the other 99% of the population. Leave your parents out of the bedroom.
Okay?
Unless it's really payback time, and then you can tell your dad and mom you're lesbian, they'll go through the roof.
Also, I am from Springfield, Missouri.
Oh, my God.
Holy Christ. What is that, some kind of Springfield hotline tonight?
That's weird.
Stop taking all the Springfield calls. Where's Sherry? Is she going home for the night? No. Sherry, Jesus Christ, how many Springfield calls are we going to get? All right, I don't care. Where the hell were we? You know what we've learned from this show? Whenever it's very important that somebody learn the truth, it's payback time.
It has nothing to do with needing to tell the truth.
Hey, think about the truth for just one second, everybody. It's important to tell your doctor the truth if you've been sexually active and he's looking for something. It's important to tell a few people the truth. But many other instances, it doesn't really matter. It's going to do is hurt people.
It's not even about lying. It's about
coming
forward with material that you're harboring that it's nobody else's business.
Right.
Okay. Not about being truthful. It's about announcing something.
Chris.
Yes.
Chris Penn is playing a win-lose or draw over here. What's going on with you, Chris?
I'm just listening to this caller.
All right.
And you guys' advice.
Thank you. Chris?
Yes.
I mean, Chris Caller?
Yes.
We'll call you Christopher.
Oh, that's fine.
You're 22. What's going on?
Well, maybe you have a little history with this or not. I'm sort of seeing dancer, stripper, whatever you want to call her, profession. But, she has a lot of sugar daddies, I guess you would say. But
she's an onion. You know what that means?
What does that mean?
Peel off one lid, there's another one underneath. Get rid of her. Throw her out and put her in the bushes.
Well, that's the thing. I worked there off and on part-time as a doorman.
You're working there, but you don't have to date her.
No, I know that, but...
Well, wait a second.
Yeah.
Is it totally nude or topless?
Just topless.
Okay.
And basically, you know, as soon as I'm there, she's, you know, all over me, groping me, kissing me, trying to get me drunk, doing whatever she can. After work, we do our own thing.
Right.
But I'm just trying to figure out. Some people say you better watch out. She'll probably play like a fiddle or...
Well, listen. How long have you been going out with her?
A couple months, maybe.
Okay, so you don't get a real good vibe off of her.
No.
And she's a little suspect. She's dancing, probably has some issues with men, right?
That's what I'm thinking.
All right, so you put a condom on, you don't spend too much money on her, and you enjoy the ride. Right?
Yeah, well, I guess you could say that, but I'm just, it's just kind of...
Starting to get sucked in a little bit?
Yeah, it's kind of nerve-wracking, you know, it's just kind of...
Yeah.
You don't know what to do, and I'm just trying to figure out...
Well, listen, this is, let me do one of my analogies here. It's been almost a day since I've compared something to a car.
Oh.
But this is the price you pay. I women are like cars. I haven't done this one in a little while. Which is, all you guys, you want to drive your Maseratis, your Ferraris, you want to look good. You want to look good around town. But there's a price you got to pay when you're behind the wheel of a Maserati. High insurance, maintenance, always breaking down, and somebody's always trying to get in it and drive it, too. They want to steal it. Or you could go drive yourself like a Pacer wagon. Leaks oil, no one's interested, leave the keys in it, lend it to your buddies. Doesn't matter, but you don't look too good tooling around town in it. There's a price to be paid for everything. Now, if you got the money for insurance and a mechanic and all that stuff, then drive your Ferrari. But don't expect the Ferrari to act like the Pacer. And this is what our caller Chris is doing. This is high maintenance here, and it's going to be a good ride, but you got to pay the fiddler. So if you can't hang with that, then you got to move on. I suggest a nice Acura, something smooth, a good mileage, but not everyone's messing around with, still a little performance. Right, Drew?
Acura screwed up their suspension.
Oh, bad suspension?
Yeah.
Yeah, what do you say, like a Lexus or something?
There
you go. Is that getting a little high class?
Yeah. An Infiniti.
Okay, go Infiniti. That's very smart. What were we talking about? Are we talking about cars? Or leasing, I think. Marie?
Yes?
You're 22.
Yeah, my question is, in September of 97, I contracted herpes, and I went to, like, Planned Parenthood, and they diagnosed me and everything, and it was horrifically painful, and I'm with the same boyfriend that I contracted it from, but I've never had another outbreak, but he has them all the time, and, like, we'll have, like, well, we've been together and had all our tests after that, so we have, you know, we use just birth control, but I mean, we can have sex even, like, after the sores have kind of crusted over on him, however gross that sounds, but I've never had another one.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, you may be having outbreaks on the inside and just not know it. Okay, you don't...
Oh, because, like, the biggest thing that I notice I'm always real careful with is, you know, urination hurts so horrible the first time I got it and stung.
Well, the
so
whole
bad.
Outbreak the first time is much, much, much more intense.
Hey, you're real careful. I mean, Marie, you're just waiting for the things to stop seeping before you dive in for some more unprotected sex. I mean,
it was with the same person.
The same guy.
He got. It was with the same guy.
No, but
actually, he contracted it from Springfield, Missouri.
Oh
for Christ's sake! Oh, he did not. What happened? He did not get it in Springfield.
That's where he was going to college at the time. He
oh, my.
Springfield is going to just, you know, you guys are going to get all kinds of letters.
And they're going to open the back door to the station, and it's going to be like an angry mob out there with torches. It's going to be like a Frankenstein or something. Jeez, I've never heard more dirt dished on one town in my life.
Never heard of Springfield till tonight.
Oh, come on, Drew. They're a big affiliate. What are you talking about?
Marie?
Yes?
It's okay that they're having sex without condom because they both have herpes.
Right.
She still has it, no doubt, but for whatever reason is not having frequent or intense outbreaks. The primary outbreak with herpes is always a lot worse.
Mm-hmm.
And very often, if people get through that first outbreak without seeing a doctor, they really don't even know they have had herpes because the subsequent outbreaks can be so mild and missed that people really don't notice that anything else is going on.
Okay. Adam.
Yeah?
You've been on hold for 50 minutes, you poor son of a bitch. What's going on?
Oh, yeah. Look, there's this girl, right?
Yeah.
And on Friday night, I, like, asked her to be my girlfriend, right?
Right.
And then she's like, I really like you and stuff. It's just that I don't know. Okay.
Uh-huh.
And I've been talking to her for, like, the past 6 days.
Right.
And she still says that she doesn't know.
Okay.
I'm like, what the hell is wrong with her?
Let me tell you what you need to do, Adam. She says she doesn't know.
Uh-huh.
Just eliminate the she doesn't part from that sentence. Let me just do some math here. She doesn't. And what are you left with?
No.
That's the answer.
Okay.
It's tough. It's confusing. It's happened to the best of us. You'll be back, brother. But don't push it.
All right.
She ain't interested. She knows you are. She ain't.
Okay.
right now.
And she may give you a million different reasons about being confused or not being ready or not knowing or needing more time.
Whatever,
but that's
it is.
All
doesn't matter.
Drew, make all those excuses. I'll translate. Go ahead, Drew.
I'm not ready yet.
No.
I'm not clear about
no.
that.
No.
You're real nice.
No.
But, maybe we could do something.
No.
Can we be friends?
No. Oh, yeah. It all means no. That's it. Listen, and whatever. Hey, if you're going in for a job interview and they go, you seem real qualified, but right now we're just... No! It all means no. It takes you such a long time. I swear to God, I'm going to lecture junior highs and explain to them what everything means. That's all life is. Listen, people don't jump across the desk and say, get out of my office. We're not hiring you. You make me sick. That suit you wear's from 1974. What the hell are you thinking about with that haircut? No, they go... Thank you very much for coming in. It's a very impressive resume, and I can tell you, I'm going to put it in a file here, and when we're hiring next, that is no. It's no. Everyone listen up. All right, we'll be back.
Loveline with Dr. Drew and Adam Carolla. We'll be right back.
Everyone go to Vegas, eat at Baccio Organico, and everyone go to New York or L.A., especially L.A., 15th through the 20th, and watch The Florentine, which is Chris Penn's new movie.
I want to say something real quick.
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
Oh, no, we wanted to just...
about 10 seconds.
No, we wanted to, you know, also thank our director, Nick Stagliano.
There you go. Great job you did.
All right, Paisan. We'll be back next week. I think, who the hell? David Alan Greer will be in here, who's always good for a good battle. He's a fun guy.
Seth Green later in the week.
And Coolio and all those guys. So, until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Dr. Drew saying mahalo.
More jello, Mom.
Mommy! This has been Loveline. The views expressed on Loveline are not necessarily those of the staff, the management, or the sponsors of this radio station. Probably not the views of Westwood One Entertainment.
Loveline is produced by Ann Wilkins Engel.
Now, please listen to this station longer.